So thank you for hanging around. My name is Tom Murdoch. I started out as a high school English teacher for about 10 years. Became absolutely interested in Moodle 1.0 and fascinated with it, and made a friend across the planet from Maryland in Australia with Martin. And he truly transformed the way that I taught. And I felt like Moodle was making it easier for me to be closer to my students. And it fit what I was doing and how I was doing it and changed things. And I eventually started hosting friends and running that on my little Macintosh at home, and realizing when I got to the University of Guam that I had to expand that a little bit because I was hosting them as well. Somehow people just found out that I was hosting it, and I started growing a business out of it, and that grew into Moodle Rooms. And I was lucky to be there for 7 years and through Blackboard, and then spent the past 3 years looking at technologies around reading, which was also fascinating to me. But I always wanted to get back to Moodle, and so I was lucky in March to come back to Moodle. What I'd like to do today, because I know 15 minutes is not very much time, is to present a way to think about how to possibly take these courses and make them more holistic, right? So how, from a learning perspective, can you talk to teachers about creating those interactions that are not foreign to them, that somehow fit into something in their teaching landscape, in their vocabulary, so they don't have to learn a Moodle vocabulary, so it feels familiar, and they can move right into it. So as some people have mentioned, right now we're looking at building out a curriculum of courses, and at one level, it's courses about features, you know, how to use the assignment module to its full extent. But a level above that is, how do I think, pair, share? You know, which is more familiar to many teachers. And in that course, we really show you the 2-3 best tools to be able to get those kinds of interactions. And then the third layer of the cake is some courses around something we're calling ideologies. And Michael Shiro, the researcher, has done some really fascinating work around ways that people teach. These are methodologies, these are ideologies. And you know, having looked at thousands of them, he really boiled them down to 4 essential models that are especially useful to us. And so what I'd like you to do as a thought experiment is to put in your mind 2 of your teachers from anywhere in your experience. And as I go through and I talk about these 4 models, and especially the academic scholar model, I'd like you to maybe categorize and see where maybe these teachers might have fallen into these 4 categories. So the 4 categories are scholar academic, which is really more about the traditional classroom. There's social efficiency, which is really about getting a group of 30 students up the mountain at the same time successfully. We can also think of this as a workplace model, where everyone needs to get up that model because they have a job to do. Then there's the learner-centered, familiar to us, and then social reconstruction, which may not be familiar to you, but I bet it is. Social justice is another name for that one. So how are we going to interrogate these 4 models? How are you going to think about and place these 2 teachers? Well, think a little bit about what they found to be successful. You know, when they were talking to you, when they were motivating you, when you were becoming the student you are, to be the person you are, were they motivating you with rank? Was it important to you to be top in the class? That is motivating for a lot of people. This is a very traditional model. This is in a lot of schools. Was this being applied to you? Were you used to going out in the hallway, you know, and seeing the list of ID names and the grades next to them? And did you memorize your friend's ID? And did you say, well, I'm going to be higher than he or she is next time? You know, if so, they were probably working from this scholar academic model. Maybe one of these two teachers in your mind was working from mastery and just said, listen, I want you to be really competent at all these things. You know, I want to make sure that you know biology and that you're going to feel very good on standardized tests and so forth. So making it nice and clear, maybe a little less about the tradition of knowledge and more about, you know, let's get this information that's always changing into your mind so that you can be very, very competent. And then maybe you had a teacher that thought about satisfaction. You know, it's great when you have a teacher who says, you know, are you happy with what you've learned? You know, is this what you thought you were going to learn? Did we meet your needs? Have you stayed interested? Are you more curious than you were before? What kind of satisfactions come out of that learner-centered experience? And then finally, the social reconstruction is another indicator of success, where you can say, you've made progress. I think you're an influential person because of what you've learned in this class. You know, I think you're going to go off and do really special things. You know, and it's that kind of buildup of you by them and by all your peers that makes learning so interesting. So the next criteria I'm going to look at is this idea of a learning theory. What is the overwhelming piece of each of these? Did your teacher that was interesting to you really follow scholastic traditions? You know, did they talk a lot about college? Did they spend a lot of time talking about what's next for you in grad school? Or were they more standards setters? Did they really want you to kind of always articulate what needed to be done and how you could do it most efficiently? Were they more constructivists, where they said, you know, you're building your own brain, and so as you stumble across different things and as you learn more, you know, it's developmental, it's a process. Are you stumbling across the things that interest you most? Are you finding out the things that you need to know out in the world? Or is it more like a developmentalist, but also keyed into sociocultural awareness? So you know that you're learning along with peers, and the peers come from different places. They have different cultures, and all those cultures are very valuable to you. And you, if you want to understand how to solve a problem like global warming, then you need to understand the cultural issues that are involved with that. There's also the primary role of learners. You know, are you being thought of as a scholar? Were you being encouraged your whole life as a scholar by this teacher? Were you kind of being groomed to be a professional? Were you being groomed to be someone who had been self-realized? Or did people think of you as a community leader? And how did they measure that? What were the evaluation types of those? You know, with traditional schools, you'd often have dissertations. You'd have long written passages. You'd get lots and lots of feedback from teachers. It was qualitative. When you're doing the social efficiency, you can lean more into standardized, something that's quantitative, something that's clear, has fine boundaries so you can get to where you need to be. And the learner-centered is more self-reporting, whereas the social reconstruction is, what kind of influence have you made? What does your social network look like? You know, I know you started a club at the school. How many people go to it? I know you decided to rally at a strike. What did that look like? Did you feel like that was successful? Finally, we know that all of these things are mixing together. We know that the two teachers that you have in mind didn't just teach one way, and the institution you went to probably just wasn't one way. But when we're thinking about making a teacher effective in a system, it is fair to reflect and say, how are they trying to teach? Because if we want to measure efficacy with beautiful analytics, it's fantastic when you can use a framework of agreement around learning and see how those tools were effective within those frameworks. So I always love metaphors because I was an English teacher, and I think it's fair to remember that scholar academics are about transmitting information. You know, I have teachers, I have students that were teachers, and I love the fact that they have students that were teachers, and there's something that's very meaningful about that. But at the same time, I'm very proud of my work at Moodle Rooms, because in many ways we were a very productive group, and we kind of built our competencies and our masteries in areas where we could, and that was a very powerful thing. I also really love the growth experience at Moodle, because we're learning this along with our community, we're learning with our partners, we're figuring out what it is that we need to do next and what to prioritize when you have 100 million users. And then I also believe in the fact that there is some apprenticeship. So there's a bit of revolution where you're trying to say things aren't good enough and we need to make them better. So if you have fallen into this idea that two or one of your two teachers was a scholar or academic, could I see a show of hands with that? Okay, not a lot of scholar academics. That's interesting. Okay, how about social efficiency by show of hands? Several of us are social efficiency. Were there any learner-centered people? Yeah. Okay, and how about social reconstruction? Yeah, California. I think that's, now that you've thought about that, and I think these are all conversations you want to have at your school. I think these are what the instructional departments can be doing so that you can begin to hit targets and find ways to be effective. You know, ultimately, you're going to be measured by your students at the end of the semester, and you want to be able to say things like have them rate you high, saying that you were that your students were encouraged to critical engagement, or that your teacher provided meaningful feedback in all of those essays that you wrote, or that you were somehow activated by the traditions of learning to understand the material more deeply. And again, this is the academic scholar one. If we were looking at the other pieces, which you can in the next couple of days by going to the other presentations, you'll see what were the targets for those. What were the people really trying to learn and bring out in their students? And once you know that, this is where it gets to Moodle, right? Because now you can say, what are the tools out of all of the many, many tools in Moodle that will most effectively help me get to that target? You know, I know that the ranking block will help an academic scholar classroom because, you know, you can literally find out how people did on quizzes and see who did the best. If you think about the authoritative sense of an academic scholar model, there's a lot of websites that are external to the school that they want to connect you to. They want you to tie you to the best microbiologists. They want to tie you to traditions outside of your school. There's also the book module where you create pages and you create chapters, and it's where you as a teacher kind of shape what information, what window you want students to look at. And then you've got the beautiful assignment module, which is very complex because it's taking feedback and it's giving you grades and it's tied to competencies, and you've got the ability to play with various pieces of rubrics and so forth. So I'm saying is think a little bit about what your purpose is. Your purpose is part of a long tradition of culture, a school culture. Probably culture is beyond that as well. And while we don't need to make you one type of teacher, we do have the possibility of helping out teachers who self-identify and giving them a template of tools to be very, very successful. And the result is, you know, these students. You know, think about the scholar academic pieces. We said ranking was important. Well, we end our school year with a valedictorian standing up front. She joins this history of scholars. She transmits the information that she's learned from you, that you learned from your professors, and she gives a speech, which is qualitative, textual stuff, which she's been doing for 4, 8, 12 years of school. So if you think about your school ending in a very different way, it's probably tied to a different ideology, and if that's the case, then it's time to align. It's time to think about what it is that you value so that you can put in the components in your course that are truly holistic and that can make your teachers as effective and measurable as you want them to be. My name is Tom. You've met Elizabeth. Mary Cooch is also part of our department. Many of you know her from the voice of Moodle in all the videos. And then Brent Parkin is also here from Australia. And I hope you'll take a chance to speak with us, talk to us about those teachers and what they meant to you and what they valued and how all that worked. And if you're interested in how to implement some of this, we'd be thrilled to share our developing curriculum with you. Thanks for your time.